I just wanted to say that for the people who missed the first session of the seminar, you can find the restitution of the talk on the blog, a research blog, which is dedicated to the seminar. And the address of the blog is just here. It's naturehypothesis.org. So soon we put also the talk of Jacket on the seminar. And for the newcomers, just I wanted to introduce rapidly the thematic of the seminar, which is to question the notion of nature in Southeast Asia in the light of the work of Philippe Despola, who recently had a great impact on anthropology itself, the anthropological discipline, in the way he tried to overpass the dualism, the dichotomy, anthropological dichotomy between nature and culture. So this new approach leads us to what we call now the ontological term, meaning that humanity is not the center of the social worlds anymore, and this kind of decentralization process invite us to study collectives, how collectives of human and non-humans do take part to the composition of different worlds and maybe different, what we can call different natures. So this also leads us to question how by decentralizing our position, it changed the way to do anthropology and also the way of understanding how arrangement, socio-technical arrangement like water infrastructure, how, you know, this decentralization position leads to another understanding of this infrastructure. So I let now Carl Middleton to present Jacket Sangamani. Thank you.
Thank you, Abigail. So on behalf of CSDS, first of all, I'd like to thank Mirasek for co-organizing this event. So we're very pleased to collaborate, and we're looking forward to the whole seminar series. So today we have Dr. Jacket Sangamani, who I think known to most of you already. So he's an anthropologist and a rural sociologist in terms of his academic training. Jacket received his PhD from the Australian National University, and his topic of study was Hydraulics of Power and Knowledge, the Politics of Water Management in Northeast Thailand. And his supervisor was Andrew Walker. And Jacket is a board member of CSDS, and he's also deputy dean in the Faculty of Political Science. His areas of academic interest include science, technology, and society, or STS studies, border studies, and development studies. So Jacket is also on the board of MAIDS, the Master of Arts in International Development Studies program as well. And then very recently, a book was published that Jacket translated by Andrew Walker, Thailand's Political Peasants, Power in the Modern Rural Economy, that I think was launched last week. Right? So today Jacket will talk about a topic that's very close to his heart and to his knowledge. The title is Beyond Nature and Culture of Modern Thai Water Engineering, the Ontology of Infrastructure. I genuinely think we're in for a very interesting afternoon.
Thank you very much, Abigail and Carl, for the introduction, and that sort of very nice capture what Despola is trying to say for the past several years. Of course, this is, as Ajay Carl mentioned in the introduction, this is the thing that sort of related to my, I don't want to say a long-term study, but it's kind of my commitment to the interest of water science, water engineering. When I was doing my PhD in 2007-2008, I actually had a chance to sort of work with a hydrologist and also being trained in hydrology during my fieldwork. Of course, my first interest was not about hydrology as a science of water, but I was interested in water management in the local context in the Northeast Thailand. But then my interest in water knowledge sort of shifted from one side to another, from very local knowledge side to the very scientific one. So, and I tried to see how these two extreme sort of knowledge can combine or have anything in common. So this is one of the ongoing process of studying. So what I try to do today is to actually have to read my draft paper, because the idea is a little bit complicated for me, maybe not for you, but in order for me to be able to express the idea and also a lot of details, it would be better for me to sort of read from this. But as I read along, there will be a lot of photos and of course the exhibition in the museum that I will show you. So you better look at the PowerPoint rather than look at me, because I'm not moving anywhere. Okay. Now let me start. And also, by the way, I'm not going to talk much about Descola today. Of course, we understand, as Abigail has mentioned about Descola World Beyond Nature and Culture, that Descola trying to sort of dismantle the divide between nature and culture. You know, this is a thing that the modern people or the modern constitution trying to classify. But what Descola and other colleagues of him, which is Bruno Latour, which I will talk about him later, trying to say in that book is that that the nature and culture sort of overlapping sphere, that we need to understand how these two things emerge together in a modern society. Okay, let me begin now. In Thailand, as elsewhere, engineers and their technologies have served the national goal of modern development. Because Thailand's amphibious geography, water engineers have played a particularly important role in this project. Over more than a century, they have invented and tinkered with machines that would help them create and maintain canals for irrigation and transport, build dams, and prevent flooding. Yet, while Thai engineers have busied themselves making machines to alter landscape, these machines also made the engineer and shaped the bureaucracy within which they operated. Moreover, engineers and machines and bureaucracy were shaped by multiple other elements, including royal support, delta landscape, and even myth and cosmology. In this paper, I analyzed the mutual constitution and historical transformation of the amphibious assemblage that makes up Thai water engineering. Located in the outskirts of Bangkok, the Royal Irrigation Department, or RID, a museum for heavy engineering, is an ideal location for exploring this issue. In the museum, the work and life of engineers are displayed and narrated, and their machine exhibited. More than classifying and displaying engineers and machines as distinct kinds, however, the exhibit also brings to life their intimate entanglements. At the first glance, the museum seemed to illustrate the separation of nature and culture, which Descola see as the characteristic of the modern. Upon further inspection, however, the museum appears more like a hybrid parliament of things, to use Bruno Latour's term. In some way, the hybridity depicted in the museum even exceeds the binary of nature and culture from which the modern and Latourian hybrid are made. Tracing the complex interrelation of engineers, landscape, and bureaucracy and statecraft and myths depicted in the exhibit, my analysis elicits the museum as a particular and peculiar parliament of things that articulate the modern characteristic of Thai water assemblage. In his analysis of the relation between modern crypto science and politics, Patrick Carroll, this is his book, outlined an analytical approach in which discourse, practice, and materiality are triangulated. Discourse includes vision and ambition, representation and ideologies in support of high modernist intervention in nature. They are interlinked with practices understood as social and organizational activities that make discourse tangible. In turn, the proliferation of both discourse and practice depend on the varied form of materiality, like machine and infrastructure. So according to Carroll, the triangulation of these domains made it possible for modern engineering culture to straddle science and government. As he summarized, the modern state is, by definition, an engineering state. Carroll's observation is important because technology museums, like R&D Museum, are regularly analyzed as a place where a conjunction of technology Carroll's observation is important because technology museum like R&D Museum are regularly analyzed as place where the conjunction of technological and state power is made explicit and celebrated. In the word of Chandra Mukherjee, it can be seen as a display of material intelligence and stewardship over nature that testify to the right of the state to rule by demonstrating the ability to rule well. The R&D Museum too depicts the history of Thai water engineering and technology in terms of continuously improving capacity to control an amphibious landscape. In this sense, the museum does indeed symbolize the technopolitical power of R&D, legitimizing expertise and authority. Yet, at the same time, something else is going on. In the following, I show that the R&D Museum also articulates a particular form of hybridity characteristic of the Thai water engineering. To grasp the modern feature of this assemblage, I activate Bruno Latour's notion of Parliament of Things. As is well known, the Parliament of Things is Bruno Latour's alternative to the modern constitution, composed of transcendent nature and immanent society, and excluding any divine power. Latour emphasized that the modern constitution is premised on simultaneously holding together nature and society, while also keeping them strictly separate. By pinpointing the de facto practical mediation of nature and society, which occur in spite of their principled strict separation, Latour captured the paradox at the core of Western modernity. Because the modern constitution allowed the expanded proliferation of the hybrid, whose existence, whose very possibility it denies, the modern were able to mobilize nature, objectify the social, and feel the spiritual of God, even while firmly maintaining that the nature escapes us, that the society is our own world, and that God no longer intervenes. Because Latour's Parliament of Things refused to acknowledge the separation of people and things, nature and society, emphasizing instead their constitutive hybridity, it offered an alternative to the modern constitution. Constitutive hybridity does lie at the center of famous actor network analysis. Subject and object, science, technology, and state power are all understood as hybrid, quasi-subject, quasi-object, whose very existence and characteristics are a fact of heterogeneous relation. In some way, the difference between this understanding and the triangulation proposed by Patrick Carroll appears slim. Indeed, in a formulation that strikingly resembles Latourian formulation, Carroll writes that while it makes sense in one context to speak about relationship between science and state, in another, it is more appropriate to speak of complicated entanglement of things material and immaterial, human and non-human, in an elaborate socio-technical network. So after this, I'll trace such complicated entanglement through the museum depiction of engineers,
machine, bureaucracy, and cosmology. Yet the very intimacy of these entanglements also problematize the assumption that there are distinct domains to be triangulated. While the notion of triangulation remains committed to the modern constitution, the following analysis of the museum as a parliament of things thus facilitate a view of engineer state as a scene of ontological assembly and transformation. To analyze the museum as a parliament of things entails paying close attention to its depiction of this process of ontological assembly. But the primary focus of this paper is not on the museum exhibit. Rather, by walking you all through the exhibit, I intend to develop an analysis of the relation and transformation characteristic of the assemblage of Thai water engineering. Since the museum itself is also part of the assemblage, its exhibit can be seen as political material that perform a particular labor on ontological opening and stabilization. So I first examine museum depiction of the career of legendary engineer Julian Nock. In one sense, this narration conforms to the conventional idea of heroic engineering. At the same time, however, this famous man is exhibited as a hybrid actor, composed of his relation with many machines, form of bureaucracy, royal power, and flooded delta landscape. Second, I analyze the historical code evolution or mangle of machine and bureaucratic organization at the RID. And finally, I examine the myths and cosmologies located at the center of Thai dam development and machine use. That these are not simply symbolic addition to the real practice of Thai water engineering indicate that this is indeed a modern assemblage that exceeds the modern constitution. A museum of amphibious thing. It inaugurated in 2007, the Royal Irrigation Department Museum for Heavy Engineering is located near a curve of the Paya River on the outskirts of Bangkok. Covering 10,574 square meters of indoor and outdoor exhibition, the main building is a modern loft house shaped like a naga, a mythical amphibious serpent related to Buddhist idea of brain, fertility, and moral multiplicity, rising above water. Carrying a logo that looked like a wheel gear, moving above a current of flowing water, the banner in front of the building read the RID Museum for Heavy Engineering in commemoration of Julian Nock Sanipwong Ayutthaya, Privy Councillor. The landscape surrounding the museum features a human-made pond, the shape of a wheel gear, symbolizing engineering capacity to manipulate natural resources for the nation. The juxtaposition of cosmology in the form of naga, bureaucracy in the form of banner, and machine in the form of gears, it immediately suggested to the ontological multiplicity of this place. The museum interior housed a great range of machines that have been used for state irrigation and water management projects. Some were imported, while others were made by RDO technical staff and engineers. Moving across land and waterscape, the museum exhibit showed them connecting and transforming the world of engineering and bureaucracy, as well as Thai data landscape. Walking into the hall, the visitor is guided to three exhibitions. In the following section, I analyze how these exhibitions compose a modern parliament of things, made up of picture and narrative. The first exhibit, titled The Biography of Julian Nock Sanipwong Ayutthaya, portrayed Julian Nock as a brilliant engineer who served the nation and the king by inventing numerous machines, modernizing the RID factory, building dams, and protecting the land against natural catastrophe. The second hall is called The Evolution of Machine Use and Design for RID Work. Here, the bureaucratic and technological evolution of RID machinery is articulated with simultaneous reference to the machine, reign of monarchy, various great men, and the restructuring of bureaucracy. And finally, with our brain and machine, depict machine as part of national development, in particular, highlighting RID involvement in the building of Thailand's famous dam. all of this sound perfectly sensible for an engineering museum built to promote state-supported technological modernization. As we look more closely at the exhibit, however, the image of Thai water engineering quickly become more complicated and quite a bit stranger. Chulanok, more than a legend. Entering the exhibition hall one encountered an imposing portrait of the engineer Chulanok. After an illustrate career at the MIT, Chulanok came to epitomize the figure of heroic engineer in Thailand. Equal by only Chuchat Kampu, the father of Thai waterman, his legendary trajectory is narrated in the exhibit. At around 8:30 a.m. on November 4, 1989, the typhoon came conceived by a monsoon trough over the lower Gulf of Thailand, unexpectedly moved into the narrow peninsula. It was the first typhoon since 1891 to make landfall in Thailand, and the most rapid and disastrous typhoon to affect the Malay Peninsula in 35 years. With winds speeding up to 185 km per hour, the storm initially hit three districts in the southern Thailand. Ashore, it struck five more districts and created a series of gigantic mudslides, containing thousands of logs that had been illegally cut and left in the mountain. These mudslides cut off most of the public transportation and caused damage to around 38,000 households and 150,000 people. Local infrastructure and buildings include irrigation dams, school, temple, mosque, as well as the agricultural land of more than 31 million acres were devastated. The monster of wind and water caused 1,060 recorded fatalities. Soon after the catastrophe, the team of high-ranked bureaucrats led by Chulanok, who was then held a senior position as permanent secretary of the Department of Agriculture, flew by helicopter to evaluate the damage. Coupled with the rubber and coconut plantation felled by the typhoon, one of the main risks was that the huge pile of logs that had been crumbled down might fuel a fire. After conducting a quick survey, Chulanok took a leading role in establishing measures for fire prevention. Returning to Bangkok, he immediately printed manual with maps and a rough guideline of operation. With the help of more than 200 tractors and the other machine dispatched from IED's countrywide unit, the vast pile of illegal logs was swiftly cleared. Then a more than 1,000 km long fire barricade was constructed. After completing this massive task, Chulanok ordered the idle tractor and truck to dig more than 1,800 ponds to provide immediate water source within the resettlement area where affected population has been relocated. Chulanok's planning and management of the post-disaster recovery and his efficient mobilization of machine and manpower from all over the country was praised in the bureaucratic circle. Locally too, he became legendary. Anyone who visits the area today will find a monumental pavilion reminding visitors of his bureaucratic and engineering achievements. In 2007, top-ranked administrator and engineer decided to name the Museum for Heavy Engineering after Chulanok in commemoration of his lifelong commitment to the improvement of department machinery. Though Chulanok passed away in 2006, his name and legend thus survive, carried on by his machine and museum. It is not unusual for either organization or museum to narrate success and progress as a consequence of the heroic agency of engineers. In fact, though, Chulanok's position in the museum is both more complicated and more ontologically interesting. As I show in the next section, the exhibit offers a picture of Chulanok as more than a legend. He is shown as a hybrid actor, composed by such diverse traits as heroic agency, practical education, bureaucratic finance, royal connections, and not least a life of intimate relation with the kind of machine. A man of walking drag lines. Born into an extended royal family in 1951, Chulanok received his bachelor degree in mechanical engineering from Chulalongkorn University, just opposite our faculty here. He then took up a position as junior engineer in the excavator section of the RID. However, he quickly realized that his formal school knowledge was of limited use for his new work amidst the machine. At that time, the section owned around the excavator section owned around 15 excavators. Most were very old, and some spent most of their time under repair. Soon after, Jalanop began working at the R&D, 200 new walking rack line excavators arrived. As they were not ready made, their assembly required extensive labor, skill, and time. Jalanop honed his engineering skill on this machine. Around this time, Thailand was about to embark on the construction of Jao Phraya Dam, the first modern construction of unprecedented size. The dam has originally been proposed by the Dutch engineer Herman van der Heijden back in 1903, when he had conducted survey of the Delta Basin. But almost half a century later, the project would be brought to fruition with the support of funds from the World Bank. Ever since, one of the most important reference points for the success of Thai water engineering has been Lach Dam. In 1950, the RID succeeded in getting financial and technical support for the Jao Phraya Dam, mainly from the US and the World Bank. Despite his junior position, Jalanop was put in charge of multiple tasks. They ranged from clerk jobs, inventory, the technical work, to enlisting and buying excavators from abroad. He also became directly involved in assembling the imported machines. In assembling the machine, the excavator team started with a smaller size excavator, then used them as crane to lift the bigger part needed for larger machine. Once assembled, the machine has to be transported to the site where they would put to work. Within the topography of the river basin, this turned out to be a very difficult task. Requiring multiple methods of transportation, the drag line excavator depended on trailers, on ferries, rails, sling, crane, trucks, not to mention other drag line excavator, as well as on bridges and roads. Illustrating this practical difficulty, the museum commemorative book narrates how the excavator once fell into the river. To rescue the sunken machine, the diver donned snorkeling equipment and used heavy metal balls to descend. They then sketched the position of the machine in order to analyze possibility for retrieval. On this basis, the excavator was dismantled underwater and brought back to the surface piece by piece using sling and forklift trucks. The whole operation lasted over a week. Jalanop developed both his organizational and engineering capacity while working under this tumultuous condition. The museum exhibit his agency as assembled in the same unruly process as he assembled them. It narrates how he became recognized as having the deepest knowledge of the machine and known that he was dubbed a man of walking drag line by his peers. Thus, Jalanop's agency is shown as outcome of mantle of practice, his legendary quality inseparable from his gradual transformation into the development cyborg. Inventing machine extending monarchy. After 2 years working in the excavator section, Jalanop was sent for a year of training in the United States. Abroad, he visited Caterpillar Westinghouse Company in Illinois, as well as Cooper Bessemer in Pennsylvania. At the suggestion of head of the RID, he subsequently continued his study abroad, concentrating on heat power engineering at Michigan University. Upon his return, he began working in the mechanic manufacturing section. From this position, Jalanop added to his status by inventing new machine. His inventive skill is made clear by the fact that he successfully devised and modified nearly 1,000 machines over a span of his career. They range from small devices like hydraulic ram to gigantic component of mega projects such as Lewis Gate Dam. To provide a flavor of this inventive practice, we can consider this modification of hydraulic lamp, the thing that you see now. This was a self-contained hydropower water pump operated by using water from local weir or reservoir, which was fed into a tube using a gate valve to control supply head. similar to the invention of diesel engine examined by Latour, in which network consisting of scientists, engineers, manufacturer, company, as well as other machine and equipment were associated and translated into a functional engine. The hydraulic ram was not the exclusive invention of the department or of Zhilanov himself. For one thing, it drew on previous innovation by Whitehurst and Mark Gonier, who has also been involved in the invention of the hot air balloons. Yet, what was distinct about the hydraulic ram was its modification, undertaken on the king's advice, with a view to make it simultaneously fit local context of use and the ongoing bureaucratic expansion of irrigation provision in support of national agricultural development. Zhilanov served in several water-related projects initiated by the king, who was a staunch supporter of the water science and engineering. Indeed, a large part of the exhibition hall in Hall 1 is dedicated to the portrayal of Zhilanov's royal service. Even after retiring from the Ministry of Agriculture, Zhilanov continued to work for many of the king's water development projects. His strong tie with this prestigious project made him widely recognized beyond the engineering community. In 1991, Zhilanov was appointed the king's Privy Councillor. There is little doubt that Zhilanov's career as an elite technocrat was enabled by his own royal pedigree. Clearly, however, more was involved than power and privilege. For one thing, the king was very invested in the water science and engineering, though obviously unable to involve himself in the nitty-gritty of the project implementation. For another, Zhilanov was widely recognized for his deep working knowledge of excavator, his useful invention, and his organizational abilities. Thus, we might venture that the king did water engineering through Zhilanov. At the same time, of course, Zhilanov did politics and career building through water engineering. Due to the importance of irrigation, water engineering is located at the core of Thai nation building. Thus, Zhilanov's career unfolded at the very heart of the engineering state. Here we find no separate domain of science and technology. Instead, what the museum depicts is a process of mutual constitution in which the invention and deployment of machine function as an extension of monarchy, while royal privilege and support facilitate the extension of water engineering, mangling machine and bureaucracy. Hall 2 presents the evolution of machines used in the IED project. A number of eminent machines and the instrument, real and mock-up, are exhibited sequentially. They are accompanied by a brief technical information and description of circumstances of their invention and period of use. In Hall 3, one continues to learn about the evolution of IED technology and their deployment in large dam construction. At the same time, one learns about the simultaneously occurring evolution of bureaucracy. For example, a detailed timeline depicted in the Hall 3, the parallel development of irrigation technology and the IED bureaucracy, showing the name and picture of the leading bureaucrats and engineers of different time periods. Thus, the exhibit depicts the machine as an integral part of the hydro bureaucracy. They narrate the mangled history in which the bureaucratic organization and classification transformed in tandem with the arrival of new machines. In 1902, the nation's first water administration, the Canal Department, was established. The department relied on a great number of machines, including dredging boat, navigation gates, and sluice gate controller. At the same time, the machinery section of the department consisted of two main units, one for technician and one for machinery. This organization categorized things according to the demand of modern democracy, modern bureaucracy, while the technician unit focused on recruiting, training, organizing, and building the social subjectivity of Thai community of watermen. The machinery unit deal with the objective side, including physical material and mechanic operation. The division therefore appear to directly reflect the modern day separation described by Descola and Ladoux. Yet the accompanying flowchart mangled this category by depicting the intermingling of machinery and bureaucracy. At the turn of 1950s, a large factory was built as part of the new ID headquarters on Jiao Phraya River in preparation for the building of Jiao Phraya Dam. More than 100 important machines, ranging from gear cutting and metal shaping machine to steel melting furnace, were used in this factory, which at the time became Thailand's largest site of machine manufacture. The ID thus became the home of many new machines. At the same time, the exhibit narrates the temporal lag between this new technology and old way of working. After just a few years of operation, the factory was run down. Meanwhile, the worker had become irritable and infected due to the low or missing salary. In the museum commemoration book, we can read about Zhuganov's pivotal role in cleaning up this technical and organizational mess. First, he guided the repair of machine and instrument. He also ordered the machine to be repainted in a vibrant green color to elevate the atmosphere. Then he set to work on solving the financial problem of the factory, aiming to improve employee motivation by ensuring they would be paid. Due to his success, productivity soared. Prior to Zhuganov's arrival, museum statistics show that 100 workers produced around 400 tons of steelwork annually. 4 or 5 years later, fewer than 400 workers produced more than 1,000 tons per year. In 1959, hydropower unit was established to serve the construction of the first hydropower plant and the biggest dam in Thailand. Built on the Pit River, one of the Jiao Phraya tributaries, and named after the king, the Bhumibol Dam would be a multi-purpose concrete arch dam. In connection with his massive project, the ID bureaucracy once again expanded its operations. At this time, the main task was to produce winch machine, sluice gate, and navigation locks, as well as mechanic parts to substitute for imports. Yet later, during the mid-1970s, ID mission expanded into land reclamation and agricultural extension, partly due to the influence of U.S. Bureau of Reclamation and financial provision from the Food and Agricultural Organization. The increased extensive irrigation canal required not only excavator and cement mixer, but also water pump and a great number of irrigation outlets. To make do with the limited budget, the ID manufacturing section thus also began to devise its own machine. The timeline depicts a steadily increasing intimacy of machine and bureaucracy ever since the construction of the first mega dam. In 1984, the ID established 5 new administrative units, each of which focused on particular machine, like unit soil machine, transportation machine, machinery factory, mechanic engineering, and machine for communication. Testifying the hybridity of Thai water engineering, Hall 2 and 3 thus exhibit machine and bureaucratic classification as mangled and co-evolving. Over and again, the new machine acquired to make it possible for the ID to operate in the Delta led to reconfiguration of its bureaucratic structure. In spite of their omnipresent and important, machines, engineers, bureaucrats, and the department do not make up the entirety of the Thai water engineering. In the following section, close attention to the museum exhibit facilitates identification of set of distinctly a modern element that also play a vitally important role in the assemblage of Thai water engineering dams and divinity. In Concrete Revolution, Christopher Sneddon analyzed dam as central hub, or what he called dam assemblage, that draw together techno-scientific expertise and geopolitical dynamics in historically specific and concrete trajectory. In the Thai context too, dam assemblage is an apt characterization of how dam function at once materially embodying architecture and technology on a grand scale, operates as a kind of water colossus, and symbolically offering a social representation of the national capacity to control nature. As assemblage, dams are intersecting points of nature and culture, and zones where science and politics are mediated and stabilized. In Thailand, however, some aspect of this mediation is stabilized, exceeds the binary of nature and culture. When the construction of Buiphol Dam was about to commence, the king and the queen presided over the opening ceremony. In Thailand, the ceremonial placing of the founding stone prior to the construction of any significant building or infrastructure is common. On the day of royal inauguration of the dam, a 60 by 40 by 60 centimeter stainless steel box was prepared. Inside the box, engineering blueprints of the dam were rolled into a waterproof tube along with the 9 bricks made from silver, gold, and copper. The king then placed the founding stone, gilded by gold leaf, and engraved with Brahmanic astrology diagram and description of ceremonial auspiciousness next to this item. The seal box was then placed in a hole under the dam foundation, located exactly 150 meters below the seat of the king. This ceremonial juxtaposed modern things like engineering blueprints with royal things like golden bricks and cosmological things like astrological sign of auspiciousness. Through the ceremony, multiple seemingly incommensurable authority, technology, cosmic divinity, and monarchy are each recognized, mutually aligned, and stabilized as part of the legitimate authority of Thai water engineering. The insertion of the literally black box into the center of the dam structure can thus be understood as a simultaneously material and immaterial sanctification of infrastructure. Composed of ontologically variable elements, hydropower infrastructure in Thailand go beyond techno-science and politics in its Western guise. Indeed, the ceremony articulates the interior of the dam as a place where the inside of technology intersects with the inside of Thai mythology and cosmology. By encompassing those cosmological or mystic dimensions which locate on the outside of nature or society binary, they exceed the modern constitution. Based on study of technological transfer in Latin America, Eden Medina and the team argue for the need to go beyond a view of science and technology as imported magic. To counter the popular connotation of technologies imported to Latin America as universally effective and somewhat mysterious entity, they argue for the importance of studying form of local innovation and use. Analyze the circulation of ideas, people, and artifacts in local and global networks, and investigate the creation of hybrid technology and form of knowledge production. The argument resonates with analysis made by Arturo Morita, which showed that modification of foreign machines to fit local environment play a very significant role in Thai agriculture. On the one hand, the idea had always relied on many imported machines. On the other hand, suggested earlier, this assemblage also in some way exceeds the modern constitution of cultural and natural objects. In the context of Thai water engineering, the question of what might lie beyond imported magic is thus very pertinent. Divine foundation stone may indeed seem like anomaly. Distracting from the more everyday process of technological adaptation, which make up most of the R&D work. In fact, however, more mundane examples testify to similar kind of access. Not only display in grandeur ceremony, common machines like Naga boat and craft also go beyond socio-technical binary. The Naga, or in Thai Na, is a serpent-like mystical creature based on canonical Buddhist legend. This amphibious this amphibious creature is said by Thai and Lao people to reside in the Mekong River and the local body of water. If lucky, one may also find its slithering prey on land and maybe on your car. According to
Buddhist cosmology, the Naga provide water to people by taking the form of falling rain. As described by Sumedh Chomsai, the Naga is central to many religious ceremonies. It figures in architecture and it is common to cultural artifacts in Thailand and throughout mainland Southeast Asia, including the RID. In the early 1920s, extensive drought coupled with the reorientation of national development toward agriculture gave birth to the first batch of Naga boats. Invented in 1925, these boats were modified iron boats with an installed Washington centrifugal water pump and a diesel engine. Their technical purpose was to provide irrigation supply, water, and elevated flooding. The sibling of the Naga boat, the Naga truck, was modified for installed Winterishima centrifugal water pump and a diesel engine. In the museum, picture and model of Naga boat and truck are displayed as a sad story of how local engineers modified universal important machine to serve local condition. As the Naga boat and truck travel to remote area, they carry along the technical action of engineers and the moral power of the state. Yet they also brought with them mystical power capable of providing rain and fertility. The exhibit suggests that the success of this machine can be attributed to their combination of the technical and the mystical, the important and the local. Of course, boat and truck in any shape might serve the same purpose of dealing with water problems in rural areas. Yet, patterned on the action and quality of the mystical Naga, water provision was changed from a question of purely technical action to one of cosmological significance. By allying with the Naga, RID bureaucrats were able to borrow its authority as a provider of welfare and fertility. As a modern political material, the Naga boat truck thus create an analogical transfer between engineering and divinity. While the Parliament of Things exhibit at the RID Museum, on the one hand, evoke a pervasive image of techno-bureaucratic capacity and the success of Thai modernization, I have indicated that it does much more than that. It ties together the material and immaterial. It interweaves technology, politics, and myths. Machines are shown as mangled with numerous other entities, including engineers, changing form of bureaucracy, natural catastrophe, royal ambition, astrological prediction, and Naga boats. What emerged is an image of Thai modern engineering as a profoundly heterogeneous and non-modern assemblage, which acknowledged the coexistence of people, machine, and spirits on the same ontological plane. In conclusion, this article or this talk today, I have examined the RID Museum of Heavy Engineering as a Parliament of Things, which exhibit the historically changing assemblage of Thai water engineering. Kasper Bund Jensen has proposed to view infrastructure as ontological assemblage, composed and recomposed by a variety of unpredictable elements. In his description, infrastructure appeared as conglomerate in which multiple forms of political material intermingle and through which practical ontology emerge. For the RID, the description is equally fitting for his exhibitions. They compose a parliament of things that display how multiple materials have amalgamated over time, thereby producing the assemblage or practical ontology of Thai water engineering. Latour's notion of the Parliament of Things and Jensen's political materials both gesture and the importance of politics. Indeed, if we consider the constant visibility of royal power at the museum, its nemesis of Thai engineering capacity to successfully deal with the unruly Delta landscape, and its narration of Chulalongkorn's legendary achievement, it might seem that the museum is about little else. Thus, we might argue with Patrick Carroll that the museum performs an ideology of legend that celebrates Thai water engineering in terms of heroic and stoic individuals struggling against irrational and ignorance. The point of the museum would be to lift up the demand and expectation of statecraft as a cure on behalf of water engineering, the blessing of the government. Yet, through the people and machine on display at the museum are certainly associated with the power of the state. The exhibit also complicates the heroic narrative. Operating through selective portrayal and juxtaposition of engineers, technologies, bureaucracy, and natural events, the parliament of things composed by the exhibit encompass not only the intimate entanglement between the body of engineers and machine, and between machine and bureaucracy, but also mystical and cosmological elements like divine stone and naga vehicles. In this way, the museum parliament testifies a blurring of nature, society, and divinity occurring at the very heart of Thai engineer state. It articulates Thai water engineering as a modern assemblage, beholden neither to the dichotomy of nature and culture, nor to any clear distinction between science, politics, and cosmology. Paradoxically, this modern assemblage has been central in propelling forward the seemingly high modern practice of Thai water engineering. Latu defined the task of his Parliament of Things as enabling ontological politics by patching together the artificially separated domain of politics and technoscience, nature and society, rather than a proper modern space that celebrates state power through technology. The museum continuously renders firm ontological boundary fluid. Looking into the ID Museum as a parliament of things, and especially inside the cosmological material exhibited in the museum, I have shown that Thai water engineers might be even more modern than Latu and Descola would have imagined. Thank you.
So I think we have time for some questions. Are there any questions for Ajay Chakra?
I have a question about what you describe this in-between cosmological world and politics in water engineering, and I would like can tell us about more how it impacts the landscapes, the national landscapes. Well, I was thinking about the name even given to the dam, which are names of the people from the royal family, I think. And if we look at the construction of national landscapes, we see also that forests or national parks are protected by the Queen, and also the water management are more the part of the King. And well, if you have some more information to describe this this arrangement of national landscape.
Yes, it has impact in the sense that, as I tried to show in this talk, that there are sort of three specific realms, right? The divinity, the politics, and also it can be culture and politics together, and also technology. They are actually not situated distinctively, but they are sort of emerged at the same time, and in this case, in the same ontological platform. If you look at other things beyond the museum itself, like that, for example, that you mentioned, you know, that my first slide here that this has been benchmark, actually the benchmark of the Thai modernist achievement in terms of water engineering. You can see that all the big dams here in Thailand has been named after royal family, Phumiphol Dam, Sirikit Dam, and Wonrat Dam, Sri Thon Dam. Can you guess which one, which dam is the largest one in Thailand? Anyone know? You can tell from the name. A lot of people say Phumiphol, but that's not true. We live in the matrilineal country, right? So, King Phumiphol Mother, Sri Nakarin, that's a big guess. So mom come before the son. And of course, Phumiphol is the biggest in its own time, but Sri Nakarin. But then, when we learn about this dam construction, the idea of the dam itself has been portrayed as the nation achievement, the development, the welfare that provided not only by the state but according to the royal initiatives as well. And this sort of have negative impact as well, that it hide away politics of the dam construction. So if any dam, if you would like to avoid politics, avoid oppression, avoid people coming out and oppress, protest about the dam, then you have to name it after the royal family to employ the sacredness of dam, royal network, and then put it to the dam. For example, in the case of Gan Sir Tan Dam in Prae province, which is has been ongoing, for 30 years already. The debate not on only technical term, of how much flood is going to create, how many village has to be relocated. That is one thing. But the last strategy that the RD or the EGAP used is maybe we should change the name from a very mundane name, like that. So that doesn't have any significant, doesn't have any auspicious, to something very auspicious that people cannot even protest or go against it. So that has to be name of the royal family. But of course, they didn't do it because that's quite risky as well. If you use the sacred symbolic entity here and then people still protest, that destroys the authority of the sacredness. So it's kind of, the dilemma, the balance that we have to really strategy, think about it.
Questions, follow up? So when you examine the museum in great depth and then you presented the narrative or the discourse that emerges from it, but as you're hinting at already, there are some very important parts of the full story missing from RID's narrative. So I wonder, like, when you think about the story of RID as represented in the museum, what are the key parts of the narrative that are missing, or the key parts of the wider story, and what's the significance of that?
Well, this is like seeing like a state to a certain extent that, they want to they look at the physical achievement, and also the man behind the achievement. But then when they look at the social, the idea of the social for them is not really concrete and cannot be observed directly. It become a background of this success case of engineering. For example, in the case of Chulalongkorn, when he went to the south to help the people who has been hit by the typhoon. There are a lot of social activities going on out there. It's not only Chulalongkorn himself or his relationship with the machine and bureaucracy that provide a solution for the this disaster recovery. But then the social part has been put into background. And this is a thing that I think it seemed like, seeing like a state like that. But then when I see it, when I say that it seems like looking like a state, it seems like a state, I don't feel comfortable about that as well, because when you want to see like a state, there's no divinity, there's no sacred kind of thing, you know. The sacredness has to be excluded from the perspective. But in this case, in a very unique case that seems like a state, but it is a modern state, it is not modern state. When Scott talking about seeing like a state, he assumed that it is a modern state always. But in fact, within this modern world, we still have a modern state, a non-modern state, which is the ID. And that is a thing that, without knowing it, you know, ID, even though they try to portray themselves as a modern organization, it is a modern, because what is embedded in their thinking, in their practice, in their discourse, is always related to mythology and those beyond the binary of position between science and society.
Any other questions?
I have two questions. I think the first one, when we look at this issue, we look at from our present perspective. But when we look at how people in the Royal Irrigation Department think, I think when including the museum and what Zhulanov do, I think it's come under the same time that Thailand is come under the idea of the modernization theory. So basically, everyone believed that modernization is good, and if we look back, even like in the 1970s, to build a dam, you at the time people will not protest. They will not see that it's wrong. Or even in the 1960s, maybe. But now people share that perspective. In that case, how the RID try to comprehend or try to explain, because the world has already changed. People start to look at the dam, not in the, beautiful idea or the sacred way, but they see that they have a benefit and this advantage from the dam. So in that case, how the RID, maybe through the museum, not only about the story in the past, but how do they redefine or reinterpret in order to say that this is also good. The second thing, I'm also interested in myth and power. And I think based on your explanation, the interesting part is that people always think about the king. Not only in Thailand, but in the Southeast Asia, that you need to produce first the prosperity of the nation and all the king, either Thailand, Cambodia, or Laos, something like that. You have to deal with the water. So basically, this is not new. But from the RID perspective, how this kind of myth or concept go to link with the issue of the power? Because I think when we're looking at the modern state, it's not necessary to be the king or the monarchy. Monarchies sometimes represent traditional state rather than the modern state. But in in your idea, when they try to integrate modernity with the modern state, and also the reinterpretation during the time has changed, and the perspective of the people has already changed, and how they're doing that.
Let me answer most of your question by pointing to this figure. This is a seven-head naga, and then the seven head represent seven branch modern hydrology in Thailand, which is the import knowledge. When you try to classify different branch of modern hydrology according to the Western knowledge, you classify it according to this terminology, and this fit perfectly. I'm not sure whether this is coming from abroad or whether they sort of modify themselves. Flood, reclamation, irrigation engineer, navigation, drainage, and storage. when you take out the first alphabet, it becomes friends, you know. And then I found this picture in the booklet of the journal that read among the watermen, the hydrologists, you know, who are being trained in the school of irrigation technique in the RID headquarters themselves. And you can see that this is a kind of modification that RID itself already practice something like that, that you bring in, you import it, you know, power from different things, you know, the scientific power of, you know, you become an expertise, an expert in modern water development, you know, through these branches. But also you are privileged in terms of power of doing things because you are not only a bureaucracy like Arthur, but you are a royal bureaucracy, you are a Buddhist based, you know, or mystical based, cosmological based bureaucracy. And that empower not only themselves to be able to do many things that other bureaucracy cannot do, but also to sort of build up their own social ideology among themselves as well. And when you look at the engineers, you know, engineer has a lot of activities, you know, just like other tribal people, you know, engineers have a lot of activities to socialize, to communicate, and a lot of rituals as well. So this also part of the ritual to strengthen the ideology or to lift up their own privileged status by engaging themselves with scientific knowledge and with, you know, auspicious of the, you know, royal or mythical authority.
Hello. I think my question is related to the Naga. I'm just curious if in your study have you found any evidence or relation in terms of the royal irrigation themselves trying to change the symbolic from the Naga to other thing or modification of that?
Well, good question. I never noticed the real attempt to change from Naga to something else. But I mean, all the time that the RID produced different logos in different occasions. For example, if you look at this museum symbols, maybe another one clear. Okay, this one. It is a kind of wheel gear, you know, and then sort of spinning over the web of water. So this is another kind of emblem, you know, that they're trying to bring in again, you know, another symbolic, another totem of gear, which is, you know, representing engineering or heavy machine, and then how the engineering, you know, make water move. So I don't think they try to change the center emblem of the, you know, Naga. Which is what providing, they still have, sort of, how can I say, they still have pride, you know, on that kind of emblem. But they also created new, you know, logo to allow different authority to get in and to make use of different, you know, power.
Principle of monkey chi is also based on natural phenomena, natural behavior of monkey. So it's just like using the nature as the cure or the solution to the problem.
Well, I asked the same question as well when I did, you know, the study on the museum, and I believe that it should be another, you know, because this one is so specific on heavy machine, and this should be, you know, like machine two, machine museum two, museum three, not the first one that I established. But unfortunately, I couldn't find the main one, which is the one in Sam Sen or the one in the new headquarters in Nonthaburi. There's no the so-called ID museum. So this is the first one. This I ask further question is why this happened. So because ID has a lot of project and has a lot of knowledge and a lot of history actually to depict why the first museum that ID built come up to be machine instead of the, you know, like the knowledge about, you know, the order, you know, the royal knowledge, royal involvement of the dam, for example. But then this is understandable because if you go to the ID, it is the organization that is run by a lot of engineers. Even though those people, for example, like those people who are graduated from Kasetsart University, you know, in engineering, in water engineering, and some people graduated from the School of Irrigation, Rongrien Chang Chol Prathan. So those people in the, you know, in the top rank administration of ID are coming from an engineer, and a lot of them have very close relationship with the machines. That, you know, they used to work in a machine factory. So when ID think about establishing the museum, the machine should be the thing that sort of the most concrete thing that they can touch, that they can feel, you know. And if they don't think too much, if they go to the museum, and they say, museum means to show things, right? To show rocks, to show bones, to show, you know, handicraft, then we have to show something that is tangible. Then what is tangible? We can't show them, we can't show our modeling system, right? So we show machine, because that is tangible and it represents, and actually machine itself is, as I mentioned, is a representation of their progress through time. When you look at them, the way they look at them is different from the way they look at a machine. The dam is sort of separate of each other, you know. Of course, a Bhumiphol dam is one thing, and then what they learn from Bhumiphol dam, then they can build Surajit dam, and they can build another dam. But still, the dam are not that connected in terms of shaping the identity of ID themselves. But the machine has more impact in the way that the ID bureaucracy structure, restructure within themselves. The arrival of new machine, you know, always create new department. You know, the recruitment of the people depends on their specialization of the machine used. So I think machine can be considered as one of the main representation that they can think of first when they think about building the museum. That's why they don't have other museum. And by the way, this museum is not open for public visit. You have to, you know, inform them for your arrival first, and then they can open up for you. So this is bureaucracy. This is a bad bureaucracy.
Sorry, I just came in at the section of your lecture. But anyway, you know, the two sort of prominent agencies in Thai bureaucracy, which carries the name Royal in English, although it's not prominent in Thai, is ID and RFD, the other meaning Royal Forest Department. I was curious, how did this nomenclature, only the English Royal, got attached to these two, and whether that somehow influences the way these two agencies think and order? Is there any correlation?
I think so. I'm not sure about the RFD, the Royal Forest Department, which next session, I think Dr. Miguel will talk about the RFD, Forest Management in Thailand. But when I compare the publication of ID, which is the one, the thing that they express themselves to the public, right? That is, if you want to communicate with the rest of the society, how can you do it? You produce a lot of publication, and they produce it every year. Many times a year.
half the book like, become a thick book like this all the time, you know, to show that like an annual report that assess within the year. So half of the book is about the king, like repeat redundant story about the king and themselves. So it will, and of course, as you mentioned, the term royal that attached to that name in English sort of allow them to tie themselves closely to the royal project, or to think that they are working toward serving the royal project. So in this sense, it's very clear in their publication, you know, that they always emphasize that. But well, I don't see the school, you know, when they have class in school, or when they have activity in school, they don't really express that idea of, you know, attachment to the king. But in the publication, it was more clear. So I'm not sure whether it really have impact on the way they think about themselves in comparison to other bureaucracy or not. But if you look only from the publication, then that is the case.
But since this only appears in the English nomenclature of the term, and then supposedly you want to convey to the foreigners that, you know, this is something special or something. I don't know whether that implicitly, you know, in the thinking, why these two agencies among, I mean, IE is the only one in the Ministry of Agriculture which carries, other than of course the Poland one, which is the royal thinking, but that one is clear, you know. But in this case, I mean, you know, where did the term royal actually first started to be attached to? Was it from the very beginning, 100 years already, that when RID first got established, that they already called themselves RID, or rather than just ID, and then RFD, when did that sort of, you know? Because in the Thai, if you want to convey to the Thai public, it's obvious already, you don't need to, or is it because they want to emphasize that, oh yeah, we tell the foreigners that we are also this or something like that.
I used to guess about it, and why it has a royal term in the English but not Thai. And what my guess is that they want to communicate with the foreigner. When, you know, they have expert, you know, coming from outside, especially those from colonial country. During the colonialism that came, you know, like British and French that, you know, came at that time. And also they want to, you know, exploit, or they want to get the resources in this area, which is the main one, is the forest. That's why we have Royal Forest Department, but not other things. And then later on, when we have agriculture, you know, the idea of royal, we put in the water. So this is the main two main resources that trying to repeat to the foreigner that this is belong to the royalty, not belong to the people. And royalty is the one who manage the resources. But other resources that have less important might not be considered important to have the name royal in front of the department. It's just a case.
I just maybe extend it a little bit. In Thailand, there are many dozens of water-related agencies. Yeah. And RID is of course one, and then PGAT mentioned. But then I was curious, does this same, you know, what you have presented applies to throughout all the other water agencies or not? In other words, do they also have this cosmology, mythological, or better say, the Metropolitan Water Works Authority, a Provincial Water Works Authority, a Groundwater, with all these other water agencies, do they also follow this same kind of, or maybe you haven't analyzed it yet? Because then I'll be interested to see whether it is just this particular agency that somehow thinks this way versus the others. Because there are also many other water agencies, and then whether, you know, how they see the cosmos, whether it's in the same way or not, or why is this one very unique.
Follow. This is the
because it's related because these two departments, the Royal Forestry and the Royal Irrigation, has been set up before 1932, right? I think it was set up during King Rama V. But my also question, right, how about the defense, the military? I think they also call themselves like the Royal as well. So is it because it's the legacy before democracy, or is it linked to the mythology that the king is the one who produced the water, something like that with the Bara, Siwa, or whatever, the Naga, that's happening, or is it because it's also linked to, I mean, I don't know, because we're also talking about politics, I mean, is it because it's a kind of the institution to claim or unconsciously claim? Because I think the royal irrigations come out during King Rama V, right? Dig the canal in Rangsit. I mean, and this is also at that time you start not to follow with what you call the danger with the rain. And the Royal Forest Department also come with, I mean, to argue again with the colonization in terms of the company, the forest concession company. Or is it related to what you call Eastern myth, like those who have to link with water, nature, something like that? If it's linked with the myth, the Igat, why not Igat? Or is it Igat? Igat has been set up after 1932 or something like that. I think that will also be interesting in terms of after, go beyond the museum, right? Something, why? And always, it's always linked, right? I think for the royal education, it's also linked with the Lake King. I don't know what you mean for the new one, but at least the Lake King, he also present himself like a water, right? While the queen also present herself as a forest or something like that. So this is related to what you call not only modernity, but also modern monarchy.
Well, I can't answer right now. This requires further research, but I think it's a good point that Ajahn Vichai and Ramon mentioned about this. Because, for example, if we look at the case of the RDE, it was first canal department. It's not RDE. The term royal came like on the third phase of, you know, name change. The first one was Canal Department, and then it changed to Intai's Gom Khong, and then it changed to Irrigation Department, which is Gom Thot Nam, and then it changed to Royal Irrigation Department, which is Gom Chonopathan. So that is interesting to look back why the word royal came on the third one, not initially the first one, and why it only, you know, apply to only to department. It might be related to what you mentioned about, you know, related to the tradition of the king providing water in that sense. But on the other hand, it might be because of the bureaucratic inconsistency, you know, like it just randomly happened. It's like somebody that I like to have the term royal or want to engage with the royal family, then they ask permission to use the term. I'm not sure. I have to look into the archive.
Going to methodology, I would like to know when and how you started to think about this new way of using ontology in your work, and at what moment you made this thought, and what has changed in your approach since you used this epistemological position.
Well, good question. I try to As I mentioned earlier, I try to look at the social socialization of the engineer before, right? And then it always comes to my mind the binary opposition between the scientific engineering on one side and the application of one knowledge project onto the social on the other. And when we look at the engineer, even though I understand that there are social factors, has been embedded within the engineering community all the time, but then I couldn't analyze them or express them in terms of conceptual analysis. And then when I found the idea of ontology, ontological term and ontology, it allowed me more to look into different kind of things. Now, I expand my interest from looking at the engineer as a person to looking at the things like the machine and the machine itself. If I wouldn't have this kind of knowledge about ontology itself, when I go to the museum, I wouldn't be interested in how the machine speaks to us, you know, how the graph or the diagram communicate with us or with other people within the machine. So in that sense, it allows different actors beyond human to play a crucial role in building up the history of IT. Without this material or without this actor, a non-human actor, we wouldn't be able to sort of narrate or give the whole picture of how IT portrayed itself. And then still, you know, it's still human and non-human actor. But later on, when I look into details, as I have mentioned, I found that even Latu and Descola that look at, trying to argue against the binary between nature and culture. Now, I think that there are things that overlapping, which is, the divinity Naga that can be sort of reward or can be remade into different kind of things. So in that sense, I see that ontology is very fluid. I think Descola mentioned about this as well, but he tried to classify it into two boxes. But I think it would be better than classifying it, fixing it into different categories, but trying to see how different ontological material sort of link or interact with each other and create new explanation or new energy in terms of expressing that own identity.
I wonder, have you worked with engineers and ontologists, and what should be their reflection on your presentations and articles?
Well, okay, I work with Western engineers. I rarely work with Thai engineers, that's my weakest point. I try to approach many people, you know. Of course, like interviewing them, talking to them, but that's not working with them, right? So for example, like, I try to approach faculty of engineering here and sort of doing research in that lab. Because I don't want to go far away to my field work. I want my field work to be at the backyard, my faculty. So that is my dream. But still, it is difficult to get access to the Thai engineering community. For example, I used to be trained in hydrology for about 5 months when I did my research. So that I want to embed myself in engineering community. So that would be the time that I spend most of time with an engineer or training engineers. So going to lab with them, studying in classroom with them, hang out with them and then read and do some of the homework with them. So I sort of understand how the engineer think. But later on when I, for example, like when I produce this paper, I haven't handed to the Thai engineer to read first and how they think about it, but also the Western engineer, the Dutch engineer, have read it. So they like it.
Thank you.
website of RIT to find the history. And interestingly, like what Jack Bates was saying, the first name was the Canals Department, and Director Rahana Fifth. And actually, the first Director General is actually the Dutch engineer. And then, during King Rahana Sixth, it was changed to Barajas Department for Putnam, and the engineer was an English engineer. And then, only later, King Rahana Seventh changed to RIT.
Right.
So,
these are all before
1932.
Yeah.
So maybe there is some historical link.
But it, very good question. Need to be prepared for time.
Well, that's okay. Do you have a final word for us? Final reflection.
Something for Abigail.
I really think it's very approach. It's very, very interesting. So it's quite new for me because I haven't met such analysis of water engineering. I think it's really a very original subject, and your approach is very innovative too. So thank you very much.
A little bit. Now I recall. I haven't talked about Escola that much. So because this series of lecture trying to understand the idea of ontological term in French anthropology, right? And of course, Escola is one of the key person in sort of promoting this conceptual framework. But as you probably heard today that I mentioned a lot about Bruno Latour. And in fact, they both are colleagues and friends, and then they share some similarity, looking at the society or the phenomenon around us. They both are the key person in anthropological terms. While Descola did his study in Amazonian, and he used a lot of ritual ethnography, Latour himself used what we call technography, not ethnography. So today I try to sort of combine both ethnography, which is the study of Killebrook, his biography, and technography, which is the study of technology as a person, as a technology has their own life, has their own living. So combining these two things, we can understand Descola from also from reading. And vice versa.